Father, we thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you that you are God with us. You are God in charge of our lives, Heavenly Father. We thank you that where two or three are gathered in your name, O God, you are right there with them. We acknowledge your lordship. We acknowledge your power. We acknowledge that you are God in charge, God with us. You love us unconditionally, Heavenly Father, that you want the very best for us in the name of Jesus Christ. And Father, we want to thank you. We want to bless your name. We want to lift you up high, even this morning in this place, oh God. Be glorified, be magnified in all things in Jesus' name. We thank you, Jehovah. We bless your name. Come on, let's give God some praise. Hallelujah. Thank you guys. God bless you. Let's clap hands for them. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Let me welcome all of you to this morning's service. And also our online church, you are welcome to be with us this morning. Please note that you can come and be part of us here physically. You just have to register. There's a link on our Facebook page that we share every week for you to register through so that you can be part of us. And also for our members, through your leaders, you can also get the same link. You can register through the link that they will share with you. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Nowadays, it's not so easy to be at church like in the past. So every opportunity you get to be here should be a real celebration. Hallelujah. David once said, I was glad and very glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. And so it's such a blessing to be able to gather together as children of God. And also, God encourages us to meet together. Amen. The Bible says we should not stop the habit of meeting one another, as some of us or some of you have done. Just because of COVID-19, it's not time for us to dodge coming to church, especially you at home. Register so that at least once a month you are in church, at least. Otherwise, you may lose touch with the reality of the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, the title of my sermon this morning is The Faithful and Wise Servant. The Faithful and Wise Servant. And I want us to read together from the book of Matthew, verse 45 to 51.
Matthew 24, verse 45 to 51.
The Bible says, who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. Truly I tell you, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose that servant is wicked and says to himself, my master is staying away a long time. And he then begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with drunkards. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. May Matsusa please pray for the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Modimo ra ria go leboga ra bogala ra le hukola ga go Jehova le leng gore ra letla gore ruta letla gore bontsha tsela morena. Mo tsatsa tsela go mpe go khosi ya di khosi re tla apela ga stilo sa ga go Jehova. Re re ra ha re tla be re tla go ja motafuleng le wena morena. A ene wena ra o tla bongwe ra gakolla o re bontsha seleng gore Jehova ra sa tlokala ra gore se ba akanye ka lokulena ka lena le matla la morena go Jesu Kriste wa Nazareth ra gore re tle re nne ba batlhanka ba ileng gore ra ba ikanyega e bile ba batshepahetse khosi ya di khosi ka lena le matla la morena rena go Jesu Kriste re ya go leboga. Amen.
Amen. You see, in the world that we live in, with the normal problems that we face on earth, it's very easy for us to forget, or as Batswana usually say, to forget yourself, and live day to day and face the challenges of the day. It can be very easy for you to live life as it comes and be caught up in the challenges of the world that you live in. Sometimes relax and forget your responsibility. One thing that a child of God should never ever forget is that there is a reason for your being. There is a reason you were born. There is a purpose you were born for. You see, the key to your successful life is finding your purpose and doing it. Because it is out of that that you will find fulfillment and joy. From our 2020 theme, the year of fulfillment, we say this is the year where the scriptures will be fulfilled. And how amazing it has become the past few months, how scriptures have been fulfilled with all of the trouble that the world is going through. So it's a year of fulfillment of the scriptures as they have been spoken by the Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament. And it is also a year where we will find our purpose, our individual purpose in life. And as we do that, we will find fulfillment in life. Because true fulfillment comes from doing your purpose. And it is out of that you will find fulfillment and joy. Now, the scripture that we have read from, first of all, is asking a question about a servant. That's the first point that I want you to take note of. Who is that servant? This servant is a servant whose duties has been assigned to. It is a servant who has got duties. It's not just somebody who is idling, who doesn't know what to do. This is somebody who actually has duties. The second thing that I want us to ask ourselves is, what are these duties? The duty of this servant is to feed the servants in the master's household. So this servant has been entrusted with feeding other servants who are found in the master's household. The third question is, when
Is he supposed to perform these duties? The Bible says at the proper time. There is a proper time of doing your duties. Hallelujah. And the fourth thing, the fourth question that we ask ourselves is, what will make the master happy? What makes the master happy is to find that servant doing their duty. It's very easy to please the master. The servant who has been given duties must be found to be doing the duties that they have been assigned to them. And the fifth question is, what will be the reward of such a servant? This is the reward. He will be put in charge of everything. Basically, he will become the deputy to the master. Just like Joseph was put in charge of everything. Number six. Question. What will happen to that servant who fails to do their duty? The Bible says, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of, and he will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is what we are talking about today. So I want to apply these questions to our lives today so that we may introspect, we may look deep inside of us and look outside of us and see where we fit in. Now, the first question that I was asking is, who is that servant? We are applying this now to you. Now, listen to what God says about you in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. This is what the Lord says. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. And I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. This is Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5.
Jeremiah.
Now, this is very, very important for us. That even though here God is addressing Jeremiah, that each and every one of us know without any shadow of doubt that we have assignments that have been assigned to us. And that this assignment did not come to us after we were born. Hallelujah. These assignments do not even depend on the fact that you became a Christian. The assignment that you have comes way before you were even born. Before you could do anything good or bad. That is why God is saying this to Jeremiah. Before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you and I set you apart. I anointed you. You see, the Bible says we were in God before the foundation of the earth. Before creation, we existed in God. We know that we have been made out of the substance of the earth, for we are from the soil. So if we existed before the creation, that means we are more than what we see right now as a result of creation. Hallelujah. So you and I were found in God before creation. And I can tell you that when you were in God, before you were delivered, and when I talk about delivery now, I want you to think about the post or office or the post box. That kind of delivery. Before you were posted on earth, everything about you, your identity, your spiritual DNA, your abilities, your potential, the talents, everything was already in you. That is the reality, that is the truth. So God deposited everything. You see, when he talks to
Jeremiah,
he says, before you were in your mother's womb, I anointed you, I appointed you. Now, this is what the devil does. You are posted perfect. Delivered perfect. As soon as you are delivered, the enemy starts attacking your identity, attacking your potential, attacking your talents. Because the world that we are delivered at is a world that is corrupted by the enemy who was given the power by our father and mother, Adam and Eve. He immediately wants to corrupt us and to make us believe otherwise, that we are not who God says we are. Hallelujah. That is why we always have excuses. Jeremiah had an excuse. I'm only a child. What does being a child have to do anything with who you are? Do you know that when a child is small and they are unable to walk and talk, that there is no limitation in who they are? The only limitation that is there is that their body still needs to develop to who they are. And so their body is limiting them. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And it is in that position after delivery on earth that the enemy tries to spoil you. The enemy tries to say you are not who God says you are. And he brings all kinds of attacks in your life, in your childhood, through your parents, through your relatives, through friends, through teachers, through pastors, who continuously say negative things or do negative things to disturb your true identity. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, you were wired in your spiritual DNA to be who you truly are. Before you made any mistake, before you messed up your life, everything about who you are is still intact. And this is what is amazing. The gifts and callings of God are without repentance. That means what he gave you before you were born is still inside of you. The problem is you have believed the enemy. Hallelujah. You have allowed the enemy to muddy. Hallelujah. When you were born, the devil took the bucket. And his hands were dirty. All kinds of dirty things. And because that dirt is on the foam that is on top of the milk, you see all of the fat. When you look, when people look, they all see this dirty thing. They say, ah, this milk. Mm-mm. Hallelujah. All you have to do is to remove that foam that has got all that debt, so that you can go deeper and see who you truly are. Hallelujah. This is what the enemy has done. And I want you to understand that God has invested a lot in you. You, the servant. And because God has invested so much of talents and everything in you, He wants a return on His investment. You see, many of us think we are just free to do as we will. After all, it's my life. Yes, it is your life. Yes, you have been given a free will. But remember, God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what they have sown. Hallelujah. As you continue sowing bad seeds, somewhere, somehow, the investor is going to come to you and will say, I gave you one talent. What did you do with it? I gave you two talents. What did you do with them? I gave you five talents. What did you do with them? Hallelujah. Are you hearing me, children of God? You see, one of the reasons why our parents get so ahead when we do not take care of them, when we do not honor them, is because they have invested a lot in us. Sometimes we are ungrateful. We have an entitlement mentality that makes it difficult for us to appreciate what our parents did. And by parents, I'm talking about any guardian who may have contributed in your early life. And so because we are entitled, we feel like, yeah, they must have done that because they brought us into this world. We fail to see the sacrifice that they made for us to be who we are. The truth is that they did the best that they could under their circumstances. And that is why if we do not honor them, things do not go well with us. And so when we do not honor God who gave us our lives, things also do not go well, as we see in number 6 of the sermon today. Now, what was this servant supposed to do? To feed the other servants. You see, in the world that we live in, it does not matter what you are doing. It will affect other people around you. It will feed other people around you. It will add value into other people's lives, or it will subtract it. You are never an island. Humans are there to serve one another and to be served by others. In the world that we live in, selfishness does not work because it goes against our makeup, the way we were made by God. Your life must be death to self, so that others may find life in you. That's what brings fulfillment. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me, church? You are not here for yourself. You will not find fulfillment in me, myself, and I. Never. No. We were never made that way. You see, when God decided to make us, it was not an individual assignment. It was an agreement between Trinity. Let us make man in our image. And indeed, we are made in the image of God. God is relational. We are relational. God the Father has His duties. God the Son has His duties. God the Holy Spirit has His duties. Three persons in God, we also have our duties that we need to perform to others. Hallelujah. That is why we do not reign from heaven. We are born out of a relationship, because our lives is about relating.
So the
third question was about the when. When it comes to God, time is very essential. Hallelujah. God times everything perfectly. Remember what I was talking about when I said about you being posted here? Or delivered on earth? God chose the time that you will be delivered. You existed in God before the creation of the world. We can safely say at least the past 6,000 years, there has been people around the world. Or more. But God chose that you be born during this year. It was all intentional. You are born at the right time for your purpose. You are right in the middle of COVID-19. You were intended to experience it. Are you hearing what I'm saying? This is what the Bible says to support what I'm saying. Acts chapter 17, from verse 26 to 28. This is what the Bible says. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history. Did you hear that? He appointed times. They are appointed times in history. He marked out their appointed times in history. He did not only mark your geography, he also marked out your time. Appointed time. And the boundaries of their land. This God. So the time that you are delivered on earth, the place where you are delivered at, and the time that you continue to live in, the places that you live in, it has all been determined by this sovereign God. While you think you are busy making choices, He has already decided. Hallelujah. The Bible says God did this so that they would seek Him. So that we may seek Him and perhaps reach out for Him and find Him. God wants us to find Him. In the COVID-19, God wants us to find Him. Although He's not far from any one of us. Now listen to this. This is Paul quoting the poets. Where he was in the Gentile land. He says, for in Him we live and move and have our being. Paul was explaining to them the unknown God. And he says, in Him we live and move and have our being. And we are His offspring. Hallelujah. This is very critical for us to understand that not only did God know us before we were delivered on earth, He chose the times that we will be born and the places that we will be at. The Bible talking about David in the book of Acts, it says, when he had served his generation, he rested with his ancestors. Hallelujah. David lived at a time that was his generation. And he served God in his generation. He did what he was supposed to do in his generation. And so he rested after that. You will only rest properly when you have served your purpose on earth in your generation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is very, very, very important, children of God. Now, the fourth question was about what will make the master happy. What makes the master happy, our master? Hallelujah. See, God finds so much joy, so much pleasure in the sons who obey him. Not just because he feels like the boss.
Like he has control of everything.
No, that's not the point. It's not because it lifts his ego. But because his design of us. When the way he has designed us. When it shows up. When we truly live to the identity that he gave us, then God is truly glorified. When we turn out to be the way we were made. Are you hearing what I'm saying? When you look at the trees, you know, sometimes you just, you know, I know we are Africans and sometimes we don't look at nature and marvel because we grew up in the, you know, in the same place. Because we grew up in the, you know, kettle poles and... Why do white people come all the way from their lands to come and marvel at the things that we take for granted? When we visit Kasani, with my family, many of the people who are in Kasani, when we tell them about all of the things that we have seen inside the park, they're like, those things are there.
You come from Gaborone to see things that we never seen.
Because it's there, you don't see it. Hallelujah. Familiarity breeds contempt. Sometimes take time and just look around at the nature. And ask yourself a lot of questions. When you see the flowers blossoming, when you see trees, you know, green and bring forth fruits, look at that and marvel. The sand, this is usually brown, the soil. But out of it comes all kinds of colors. Is that not amazing? From a very small, very, very, very small seed comes out this amazing creation. When trees become the way God made them, when the grass come out and the cows come to eat the grass, which is green, and they make meat that we love, red meat. From green comes red. You must look at that and marvel. From brown comes green, and then from green comes red. You don't eat grass directly, but you eat it through the cow. Is that not amazing? This is God. When all of these things become like that, they glorify God. Plants glorify God. You need to glorify God with your life. Hallelujah. This is what glorifies God when we become who we are born to be. When we are faithful to our true identity. But this is what the enemy will do. As soon as you are born, he brings all of this pain on you to confuse your mind, to negate everything that God says you are. Now and then you see glimpses of dreams. You have a vision of the future. You see how great you are. And as you are marveling at the greatness that you see, the devil says, ah, remember they told you that you'll never make it in life. Look at your background. Do you think somebody from a village, you were taking care of your grandmother's goats? You are just a shepherd. Just agree and relax. Stop dreaming. Low self-esteem. The devil keeps on hammering you. Because one of the biggest things you can do, the biggest harms you can make in the devil's kingdom, is to find who you are and begin to live out your purpose. Don't believe the enemy. And then it is, you know, it is from all of those lies of the enemy that we have many excuses. Moses had an excuse, I can't speak properly. Jeremiah had an excuse, I'm small. Gideon had an excuse, that is from the smallest family, smallest tribe, smallest every. Don't we all have an excuse? How does God feel after knowing everything that he has given you and all he hears from you is excuses? All he hears is complaints about this. I'm also guilty of complaining. Sometimes I want certain things to be done in a particular time and God is taking his time. And I complain. And then he rebukes me. I don't want to directly complain to him. I just say, But God knows I'm complaining about him. How many of you have complained? You are afraid of complaining. God, you are not fair. But you know you are actually saying it. Do you know what God did to the Israelites for complaining in the desert? When we complain, we show a lack of faith in the God who has invested in us. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me? Sometimes our religiousness becomes such a stumbling block. Religion is terrible. It requires your performance. Perform. After you have performed. You know some of the complaints that I give to God sometimes. God, I'm so faithful. Do you see how I'm suffering in this office, serving your people? I'm suffering. I'm just here suffering for them. God, are you not seeing? Why don't that prayer request, it's been 6 months, now you haven't answered. But look at me. I'm so suffering, God. When I do that, what am I saying? I'm saying, God, you need to pay me back. Huh? God gives me gifts to serve his people. Now I feel like I'm a big guy. He must pay me. Entitlement. We always feel entitled. If things don't work out our way, we throw tantrums. And God watches us. Watches us throwing tantrums. When we are done, he says,
are you done? Let's go.
You remember Elijah who was throwing tantrums? He says, it's better I die. He was saying, better I die. He was given food by ravens. Eat. Then he slept again. He was woken up again. Eat. You have a long journey ahead of you, Papa. There is a long journey ahead of you. Stop being discouraged. Why was Elijah so discouraged?
Huh?
He killed all the prophets of Baal. He shut the heavens so that it doesn't rain. And then he showed them who the real God is. And he was expecting revival. There must be revival. Everything must change. The next thing, Jezebel is threatening him. And he's running away. He's like, God, what happened? I killed all of these guys and then this woman.
Yeah.
No,
I'd rather die.
Hallelujah. What has offended you? Huh? What hasn't happened that you're expecting to have happened by now? Hallelujah. The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. Don't let him steal your joy. Don't let him kill your desire for God. Don't let him destroy your future. Keep on believing God. Let me tell you, your angels rejoice every time you fulfill your purpose. But your angels are grieved when you believe. Leave the enemy. And you do not do what you are meant to do. The angels have been sent to assist you in fulfilling your purpose. Hallelujah. The fifth thing is about the reward. The master. Oh, God rewards those who diligently seek him. Isn't God amazing? He gives you life. Then he gives you gifts that you need to succeed in life. Then he rewards you when you use the gifts that he has given you in the life that he has given you. Oh, the devil tried so hard to negate everything that Joseph was. But Joseph remained faithful. As a young man, he saw clearly the dreams that God has for him. And he shared innocently. And the enemy started a crusade against him to destroy those dreams. How did he do it? By those who were closest. The family.
Huh?
The enemy usually uses our family. Because they are the ones who have access to us, to our vulnerabilities. So they hated him. They tried to kill him. Then they sold him to slavery. Don't let the betrayal of those closest to you stop you from fulfilling your purpose. Don't let being sold to slavery stop you from fulfilling your purpose. And then when he was in Egypt, he was falsely accused. Don't let false accusations stop you. He could have said, ah, God, I've tried to be faithful. Now look at this. I'm being accused of things I never did. He could have thrown himself on the floor and kicked, but he remained faithful. Do not allow going to prison stop you. Be faithful even in prison. Hallelujah. And at the right time, oh, when the time is right, the master will take the servant and put him in charge of everything. Is that not what happened to Joseph? Hallelujah. We can learn from the story of Joseph. Now, the last question, number 6. What happens when we fail? Oh, it is terrible. Although we have the right to choose our lives, we must know that God cannot be mocked. That a man will reap what they have sowed. Yes, you may be free to do what you want. But remember, there is an investor who has invested a lot in you. At the end of your life, he's looking for his returns. He wants to know what his investment has birthed. He's looking for profit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to understand this. When life is normal and everything seems okay, suddenly, the thief will come. When everything seems okay, Remember the story of the 10 virgins? The 5 were ready, the other 5 were not ready. Hallelujah. Remember during Noah's time, the Bible says they were, you know, having parties, drinking, marrying, getting married, and suddenly the flood came. Don't allow a time of relaxation and normal life take away from you the urgency of you fulfilling the purpose for which you were born. As I conclude, this is my encouragement. No matter what is going on around the world we live in, no matter the challenges that we have around us, eyes on the ball. Don't forget who you are. Eyes on the ball. There is so much noise around us. So there are so many complaints around us. But our eyes must remain on the ball. Hallelujah. We are here as aliens who have been sent on a mission from our kingdom to rescue as many humans as possible. We should not be entangled with the affairs of this world and forget our true identity. We don't think like the world. We constantly refer to our kingdom for guidance. For the world that we are from is not like this world. That's why we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In heaven, the perfect will of God is done, and we must bring it here. In heaven, there is no coronavirus. We must bring that here, where coronavirus is eliminated. Let us not be taken by surprise like the rest of the world, because let me tell you, God has a surprise for the world. We should not be taken by surprise. Let us be counted. Let us get busy so that when our master appears, we will be rewarded accordingly. Otherwise, we may think that he is cruel. He has invested so much in us, and he will want a return on his investment. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for challenging us this morning to be both faithful and wise, O God. Great I am, King of kings and Lord of lords. You are able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could ever think of, imagine, or even ask for. And Heavenly Father, today we come before you and we ask that you will help us to revisit our true identity, O God, and to fulfill the purpose for which we were born in this world, O God. Help us, Jehovah, to rediscover who we are in you, Jehovah, so that we may walk according to our original DNA, O God. Yes, the enemy has tried with everything he can ever since we came into this world to nullify our true identity. We pray, O God, that you will help us so that we will recover who we truly are, even as we align with your will, O God. Father, we thank you and we bless your name in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you. Thank you so much for joining us. Let me pray. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Father, may your face shine upon your children, O God, and may you give them peace. We ask all this in Jesus' name. The Lord bless you.